Good morning. Thank you all for coming to this most exciting day. My name is Joe Demento. I'm professor of law and society and planning here at UCI and the director of the Newkirk Center for Science and Society. It is my distinct pleasure to have the opportunity to introduce Dr. Michael Drake, who is the fifth chancellor of the University of California Irvine. He has been with us now, to our great delight, for almost 2 years. He formerly was vice president of health affairs for the University of California system-wide, where he guided 15 medical-oriented units of the University of California: nursing, pharmacy, medicine, dentistry, public health, optometry. He oversaw the UC special research programs, including the very important tobacco-related disease research program, the breast cancer research program, the HIV/AIDS research program, and the California-Mexico Health Initiative. Before that, he was the sharing professor of ophthalmology and senior associate dean for admissions and extramural academic programs at UC San Francisco. He's written dozens of scholarly articles and chapters and co-authored 4 books. It's a great pleasure to introduce Michael Drake.
Thank you, Joe. That was very kind. You know, I've heard that introduction so many times, I was expecting to be the sixth chancellor by now, but I'll stay where I am. Very nice to see you all this morning for this very important day of talks. We, as a campus, confront many issues on many levels, and no one is more important than the issue that will be talked about today. And this is sort of a place where there's a nexus of science and policy, of people and laboratories, of people in this country and around the world all come together and work to help guide the world to a place that we'd like it to be. The place where I think we struggle is the social science. We struggle a bit in policy, getting things implemented that make sense. We struggle in getting along with people or understanding different points of view. We're better at building things that we can use to blow people up who we don't agree with than we are at understanding why they might have a different point of view and working those things out, not to be too political. But you know, we really are. You know, there are many more wars around the world in little and big places and countries we've never heard of than there are great treaties and celebrations of peace, which is what we'd like to have. And so one of the things that's great about what the Newkirk Center does is it brings together policymakers and scientists so that we can have the answers, but then also apply the answers to have them be relevant. I want to recognize 3 people. Excuse me. The first is Joe Demento, who is the director of the Newkirk Center. And then among our favorite friends in the community, Martha and Jim Newkirk. I see Martha and Jim in many contexts because they are supporters of the University of California Irvine in many contexts, really do support this community broadly. And then I'd like finally to introduce our featured speaker this morning, Professor Sherwood Rowland. In 1974, Professor Rowland and Mario Molina, who was a UC Irvine postdoctoral research fellow at the time and is now at the University of California, San Diego, co-authored a paper linking chlorofluorocarbons to the depletion of the Earth's ozone layer. And this led to a world ban on CFCs and the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1995. I guess that means I should hurry up. With no further ado, Sherry is now the Donald Bren Research Professor of Chemistry and Earth System Science. He advises world leaders on the impact and dangers of ozone depletion and global warming. A lesser known accomplishment, and one I know that he's quite proud of, is that Sherry was the MVP on the Toledo Naval Base basketball team in 1946. And And the way they've been doing lately, I think you could probably help them even today, Sherry. So please join me in welcoming one of the world's great scientists and one of our great citizens, Sherry Rowland.
Thank you, Michael. As a member of the Irvine faculty since the starting days, I would like just to throw in something that's a follow-up there, that there were, in 1965, there were seven chemists and eight physicists and about 15 biologists. And now looking at it back in time from the present time, of those 30 people, three of them had Nobel Prizes, which is unusual for any university, but especially for one just starting out. Well, we'll see how we do on, do I have to point this up there? Okay, one of the things that one hears or reads about is the statement that when it comes to global warming, that 30 years ago, everybody agreed that it was cooling that we had to worry about. And so I just put in this slide which shows what the science editor of the New York Times said in 1975. Not only are the basic scientific questions largely unanswered, but in many cases we do not yet know enough to pose the key questions. And the people that were being quoted by Walter Sullivan then were people who have mostly passed on. It's not true that the same people now were saying something different 30 years ago. The leaders of science turn over much more rapidly than that. And so the ones, especially the ones that are going to be quoted by the New York Times. So that was a different group, but it was very much different in the way of what science could be done. And this is my introduction into the atmosphere of having been at a meeting in Fort Lauderdale at which I saw some results presented in which it indicated that a molecule, trichlorofluoromethane, had been detected in, not only in the northern hemisphere, but in the southern hemisphere. And that was intrigued me, but it was what it really represented was the push of analysis in chemistry had gotten to the point that you could measure not compounds that were present in one part in 10,000 or one part in a million, but one part in a billion or even a trillion. And when you go to a billion and trillion, there are a lot of things going on, some of them very important, and the trichlorofluoromethane was important in that sense, even though its level of concentration measured over here was only 80 parts per trillion, which is not very much, but it was enough to be serious. And this information was published a year later by Lovelock in Nature, and those are the same data that had been described in the meeting that I saw before. And I'm not going to go into detail except to say we're all familiar with the ozone hole now, which is one of the consequences of the chlorofluorocarbons being in the atmosphere, and it's also one of the driving forces for the first successful international protocol, the Montreal Protocol, which banned the use of ozone-depleting materials. And in connection with that, we needed to have samples in both the northern and southern hemispheres, and weren't funded to do any of it. And so I went to the Graduate Council and got $1,500 to send a postdoctoral to Chile and Bolivia, and then bootlegged some measurements here. And this has grown into being a main aspect of what my research group does. This is a typical analytical sample, and what one can see down here is that there are a whole set and very good evidence here. And then another sample in which you see hydrocarbons and with a lot of ethylene and